of the Islamic Society of Delaware. We welcome you to the open house. This is the second of three sessions, and we hope over the course of an hour and a half to foster a better understanding of Islam through the words of two of our scholars and one of our sisters on three topics that we think are relevant to build bridges between Islam and other faith communities. You all have a copy of the agenda, and we also have some guidelines, and we also have activities at ISD you can be part of, and I'll give you a bit more information towards the end. And during the Q&A session, you have those index cards, you can write your questions, pass them up front, and Sheikh Hadi and Imam Shaleen will do their best to answer your questions. So without further ado, I'd like to invite the first speaker. He is Sheikh Imam Abdul Hadi. He is the Imam of Masjid Ibrahim. He is also a scholar from Al-Azhar University in Cairo, Egypt. And he is a Hafiz of the Quran, meaning he has memorized the entire Quran from cover to cover. Sheikh Abdul Hadi, Shehab.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. In the name of God, the most compassionate, the most merciful. Dear respected brothers and sisters, I begin by thanking you all for making the effort to attend this important event. And actually, we cannot tell you how much we look forward to the times that we will meet, because we believe that we have learned a tremendous amount from each other. We have much in common. We have much in common, despite the ongoing conflict. Actually, we do share so many things, and we agree more than we differ. Allah the Almighty says in the Quran, O people, we have created you from a male and a female, and we have put you into nations and tribes. We have made you into nations and tribes so that you may get to know one another. So the different religious communities actually is part of God's plan. It is part of Allah's plan. But at the same time, we do share so many things. We have much in common. And we believe that all the prophets and the messengers of God have taught the same values, the same morals, the same principles, the same rules. They taught us the values of love, respect, compassion, and peace. All of us share the same world, despite the differences in our skin color, race, religious affiliation, but at the end, we meet at some point. And we believe that we meet at some point at the end. Today, my part is to summarize 23 years. Yesterday was actually 20 minutes. Today it was dropped to 15 minutes. So today my part is to summarize 23 years in 15 minutes. I don't know how this doesn't work, but we'll try our best. So the first part, hoping, God willing, that these sessions will lead to a better understanding between each other, also will help to dispel misconceptions about the Islam and Muslims. And we, as you all know, that Islamic beliefs and practices, this is one of the most important part of our religion. What is to be believed in? And these actually three topics were chosen for a reason, and very important reason. So the Islamic beliefs and practices, the second session you will be hearing about women in Islam, the third you will be hearing about the sanctity of life. Because this is actually what we hear all the time, so we wanted actually to clarify any misconception about these three topics. Islamic beliefs and practices. You know, we have something in Islam called the articles of faith and the five pillars of Islam. Most of you probably are aware of the five pillars of Islam, which is the shahada, the testimony of faith, the prayer, fasting, the charity, pilgrimage to Mecca. But the six articles of faith are not mentioned often. So this is what we believe in. We believe in Allah, His prophets, books, angels, the last day, meaning the day of judgment, and we believe in the predestination, the divine decree. And belief in Allah is the cornerstone of Islamic faith. And all of the other Islamic practices and beliefs revolve around belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we believe in the oneness of God with respect to His Lordship. We believe in the oneness of God with respect to Him alone, being the only one who's an ilah, who's God, has no partner, has no wife, has no children. And also we believe in the oneness of God with respect to His names and attributes. So His attributes are perfect, are complete. His attributes are unique to Him, and no one can attain any of God's attributes. We believe that He has control over everything, just as you believe. I think we have the same thing. And nothing happens without His permission. And also, life and death are in the hand of God. Guidance and misguidance are by the will and permission of Allah. And we believe in that. Put the slides in front of me instead of... Okay, and then we believe in the prophets of Allah, prophets and messengers of Allah, and Muslims are not allowed to reject or deny a single prophet. But in Islam, denying one prophet or messenger is a form of disbelief. It takes the person completely out of the fold of Islam. Completely. So Muslims believe in each and every prophet was sent by Allah. From Adam, peace be upon him, Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, Joseph, Jacob, David, and the last prophet, Muhammad, peace be upon him. And as you can see, the Quran mentioned 25 prophets by names. So there are 25 prophets mentioned by names in the Quran. It does not mean that these are the only prophets that Allah has sent. There are much more than this, but the Quran mentioned 25 prophets, and as you can see, the names in front of you. We believe in the books of Allah. Books that includes the Quran, the Bible, revealed to Prophet Jesus, Isa, Torah, revealed to Prophet Moses, and also Az-Zabur, revealed to Prophet David, and the scrolls of Prophet Abraham. So we believe in the books of Allah also in the same manner or in the same way that we believe in the prophets and messengers of God. And also denying one book takes the person completely out of the fold of Islam. So for example, if someone says, I only believe in the Quran, I don't even believe in the Bible and the Torah, he's not Muslim. He's not Muslim. It is part of our faith is to believe in all the books that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent to His prophets as a mercy and a guidance to lead mankind to success and happiness in this life and in the hereafter. And also we believe that the Quran is the final book of revelation revealed to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, at the age of 40, over the period of 23 years. So he did not receive the Quran at one time, but it was revealed upon him over the period of 23 years. and the Quran was revealed in Arabic language. It was memorized by millions of people. You can easily find 5 years old memorized more than 600 pages from the Quran from cover to cover in its original language. Even though if the child does not even speak the language of the Quran, he has to memorize it in Arabic. He cannot memorize it in English. That's why the way we pray, we have to recite the Quran the way that it was revealed upon Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. We believe in the angels, that angels are a type of creation of Allah. They have been created from light. They are from the unseen world, but we do believe in their existence, in their actions, and actually denying them, you are denying the coming of revelation. Because, for example, the Quran came to Prophet Muhammad through Angel Jibreel alayhi salam, Gabriel. And we believe that some angels have been given a specific responsibility. Like, for example, Jibreel is the Jibreel is in charge of the life of the heart, meaning the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Israfil, for example, is responsible for blowing the trumpet that will resurrect the bodies on the Day of Judgment. And then we have Mikael, for example, is responsible for the rain and vegetation and the sources of life. And we believe that from the moment an individual is conceived in his mother's womb until his death, even beyond that, angels play a role in the human life by accompanying them, protecting them, keeping a record of all of their deeds. So we believe in the angels in the same way that you believe. We also believe in the last day, meaning the Day of Judgment. And it was called the last day because there will be no day after it. And a person's new life will be decided on that day. It will mark a new beginning for each and every soul. And also this step may lead to eternal bliss or eternal damnation. This is the day that all of us will be standing in front of God. We will be questioned, our deeds will be weighed, and at the end will be granted paradise, or God save all of us, the hellfire. And also we believe in that destiny, the divine decree that everything has been recorded. And this is definitely the knowledge of God before He brings us into existence. So He said in the Quran, there is a verse, no calamity, nothing happens or takes place on earth or in yourselves, except that it has been recorded before we bring it into existence. And this we believe in, that the divine decree, however, He gave us the free will. He gave us the free will, because some people might take this as an excuse. It's not my fault to do bad because God has decreed this for me. He gave us the ability to do good. And He gave us the free will. These are the 6 articles of faith. We believe in Allah, prophets, angels, books, last day, and the divine decree. As you all know, Muslims also believe in that Islam has 5 pillars. Number 1, this is the most important thing, to believe in that declaration of faith, which is there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. And this is a statement that makes someone a Muslim. For someone to enter into the fold of Islam has to recite the statement of the declaration of faith. There is none worthy of worship except Allah, and Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. Also, we pray 5 times a day. As you know, Muslims pray 5 times a day. Prayers are a type of purification for a human being. So we meet with our Lord actually 5 times a day. It is the showing of one's need and dependence upon the worshipped one. And this is also, it purifies our sin. The Prophet, peace be upon him, told us that the 5 prayers, like someone had a stream outside of his door, and he bathed in it 5 times a day. He takes a shower 5 times a day. And he said, would any filth or dirt be left to him? The companion said, no, no messenger of Allah. And he said, this is like the prayers through which Allah wipes out your sins. This is actually the soul of the religion. We have also the charity, and definitely we pray at certain times, 5 times a day. It's not left to us, we pray them at any time we want. We cannot combine the 5, for example, in the morning and say, so I can have rest the rest of the day, or I can pray all of them at the evening. Each and every salah has a particular time. But if you have a valid excuse, you have the permission from the Sharia to delay it. Yani under some circumstances. And then we have also from the 5 pillars of Islamic charity. This is actually guarantees the rights of the poor. And this is also one of the 5 pillars of Islam. And there are some types of people who are eligible to receive our zakah money. This is also one of the 5 pillars of Islam. It was mentioned in the Quran. The zakah, prayer and salah were mentioned in the Holy Quran more than 100 times. More than 100 times that establish the prayer and give the charity, because it actually purifies our hearts, our souls from stinginess, from miserliness. It also creates a love between people, because otherwise the poor people would start hating the wealthy people who do not share any part of their money. So actually it removes hatred and enmity from the hearts of people. We fast the month of Ramadan from sunrise to sunset. It's a common sun problem, less than 2 months. As you know that this year we might be fasting for 15 hours a day. 15 hours a day, that means we are not allowed to eat nor drink anything at all from sunrise to sunset. But actually giving up the food and the drink is the easiest part of fasting. It's not about stopping eating or drinking, but the Prophet, peace be upon him, told us, whoever does not give up false speech and act upon it, Allah has no need of him giving up his food and drink. So actually this is, it's a kind of discipline. It's not about eating and drinking. A person may suffer the whole day from hunger and thirst, but he did not achieve the proper goal from the fasting. It makes us also sympathize with the poor and needy by gaining a sense of their suffering from the hardships of hunger and thirst. We can talk about poverty day and night, but if you did not taste it, you will not be able to feel it. So feeling actually the pain of hunger and thirst will make you more generous, will encourage you to do more and to think more about others who are less fortunate. And then the last thing, we perform Hajj once in our entire life, if we have the means to do so. Meaning if you don't have the money, Hajj is not obligatory upon you. If you are physically ill, Hajj is not mandatory upon you. You have to be able financially and physically, and then you can go. This is one of the most also important acts of worship. It's a great opportunity for Muslims to meet each other, to get to know each other. If you can see, probably you have seen this before, that we dress in a similar fashion, regardless where you came from, regardless whether you are a president or not, regardless whether you are from high class, middle class, lower class. At the end, we dress in a similar fashion, perform the same rites, and there is no preference, no distinction given to anyone based on nationality or race or standing in the society. This is something very important, and as we said, that it is a particular traveling at a particular time to a particular place. It is a journey to Mecca. When we go around the Kaaba, and the Kaaba, we believe that this is the first house of worship built for mankind, and it was built by Prophet Abraham and his son. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran. Hopefully I did not exceed the 15 minutes. Did I? Okay. Thank you very much for listening. God bless you all. And we cannot, truly we cannot suppress our happiness that you are here today. This is a great honor for the Muslim community of Delaware. And we are in desperate need of these gatherings, of these events. Because as we said, we share the same world. We see each other every single day. Our neighbors are not Muslims. We have no way but to deal with each other and interact with one another. We love you, we respect you, we have nothing against you, nothing against you, nothing. We have been commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran to treat you with kindness and respect and gentleness. Thank you very much.